स्वस्ति वस्तु चिदाभासकोधीषु जीवोऽपि तद्वत् यथा दर्पणाभाव आभासहानौ मुखं विद्यते कल्पनाहीनमेकम् तथा धीवियोगे निराभासको यः स मनश्चक्षुरादेर्वियुक्तः स्वयं यः मनश्चक्षुरादिः मनश्चक्षुरादेरगम्यस्वरूपः य एको विभाति स्वतः शुद्धचेताः प्रकाशस्वरूपोऽपि नानेवधिषु प्रकाशस्वरूपोऽपि नानेवधिषु अगेन The two sibilants, you know, sha and sa coming side by side. Prakashaswarupopi nanevadhishu.
Prakashaswarupopi nanevadhishu.
Sharavodakastho yatha bhanurekah.
Sharavodakastho yatha bhanurekah.
यथानेकचक्षुः प्रकाशोरविर्न नॉट नः जस्ट न नः वुड मीन अस या टू अस यू नो मानो नः मे नो नः नः मीन्स यू नो अस्माकम् Or asmabhyam, you know, that's what. Either for us, to us, or ours. So, naha, if you say, it will change the meaning. It is a simple no, na. Okay, so we'll do this again. Yatha neka chakshuf prakasho ravirna.
Yatha neka chakshuf prakasho ravirna.
क्रमेण प्रकाशीकरोति प्रकाश्यम् या लेट्स बी ऑन द सेम पेज लिटरली क्रमेण प्रकाशीकरोति प्रकाश्यम्
क्रमेण प्रकाशीकरोति प्रकाश्यम्
आई सॉ द डिफिकल्टी यू आर हैविंग डिफिकल्टी बिकॉज Kramena, the na, which is followed by, which is a simple vowel followed by a conjunct consonant, what happens to when you chant? Is a doubling called dvitvam. So that kramena, the a in the na, when it is followed by a conjunct consonant, and like Rama Prasad, you don't say Rama Prasad, Rama Prasad. So here the same pra is here. क्रमेण प्रकाशीकरोति प्रकाश्यम सेम थिंग विद करोति एंड प्रकाश्यम देयर इज दैट लिटिल यू नो दैट्स व्हाई इट गॉट अ लिटिल ऑफ सो आई विल चांट अगेन एंड यू डू दिस क्रमेण प्रकाशी करोति प्रकाश्यम्
क्रमेण प्रकाशी करोति प्रकाश्यम्
Saw the difference?
Mm. Yes.
Yeah, that's what it is. अनेकाधियो यस्तथैक प्रबोधः
अनेकाधियो यस्तथैक प्रबोधः सकीयोपलब्धिस्वरूपो महात्मा
विवस्वत्प्रभातम् यथारूपमक्षम् प्रगृह्णाति नाभातम् एवं विवस्वान् यदा भात आभास यत्यक्षमेकः
यदा भात आभास यत्यक्षमेकः
स नित्योपलब्धिस्वरूपोऽहमात्मा Yeah, this is all practice because you know one thing if you learn really to read and chant it will help the other texts also. It's not that we are just practicing this text. Only three more verses are left. Why are we practicing this text? Because this text, the ability to read, even with the help of what is that language called? Transliteration language. That's a big achievement, you know. Yeah. It's a wonderful thing. So please don't think that we are wasting 10 minutes of every class trying to, you know, chant something that is going to get over next week. This is so that practice of reading comes. And the more fluently that you're able to read, the more you're able to enjoy. And the more you're able to read quickly, the more you see the patterns of the various rhythms in the meter. And all these various things you sense. Not only that, certain words keep coming, especially in Vedanta texts. I mean, what other things? Prakasha. What does Prakasha mean?
Light.
See, everybody knows, you know. And Yatha. What does Yatha mean? Just as. You know, Tatha. Similarly, in the same manner. So like these words keep jumping the more you learn to pronounce them. Because in the articulation of a word, is the respect given to that word. You worship the word, or you don't worship the word. There's only one word to worship, that is Brahman. You worship Bhagavan through the correct articulation of the word, and that word blesses. That's what it is. So therefore, we take the time to chant this, and chant anything, so that the idea is, it sticks, you know. Yeah. That is what it is. Makes a little place in the heart of the intellect. So let us see this. Vivasvat prabhatam. Vivasvata prabhatam. What is vivasvata? Vivasvat like marut. Keep chanting. Marut. Next one. Marutau. Marutaha. Then. Marutam. Next. Marutau, Marutaha, and then third case of Marut, Maruta. Here, what is it? Vivasvata. What is third case means? What is the third case? Instrument of what? Instrument of the action. So here, Vivasvata. What is the action here? You know, prabhata karanam, the lighting up is the action. So, vivasvata prabhatam. And what is vivasvata prabhatam? Lit by the sun. Yeah. So, that becomes a compound. Vivasvat prabhatam. Tritiya tat purusha. So, this is a compound. Like gas station, a station where gas is dispensed, you know. So that's a different kind of compound, you know. And here this is the instrumental compound. This is called an instrumental compound, where the compound is in the form of an instrument, you know, and so what the actor is, you know, is the first, you know, the first thing in the compound, and that upon which or because of which something happens is the second word of the compound. So vivasvata prabhatam, vivasvat prabhatam, so lit by the sun. Okay, all right, lit by the sun, so what? Yatha, just as aksham rupam pragrinhati, yatha vivasvat prabhatam aksham rupam grinhati. So what is lit by the sun here now? Of all the words,
rupa
is goes with pragrinhati. Aksham, what does aksham means?
In Turkish it means evening swatch.
Okay, let's clarify. What does it mean in Sanskrit? Bhadram pasye maksha bhiryajatra akshabhi. There also, what is aksha? Aksha, eyes. Very important word, eyes. Not ice in the freezer, eyes. Yeah. Chakshu and aksha, same. You know, when the meter is allows chakshu, chakshu will be used. Like in the last verse, chakshu was used. And here, aksha is used. Aksham means, and aksha in Sanskrit is also confusing. Aksha means dice, you know, a game of dice. That Duryodhana and Yudhishthira got into trouble with that. Thanks to Mama. Who is Mama? Uncle Shakuni. Uncle Shakuni. Shakuni loaded the dice. Anyway, so aksha here, aksham means the eye. Okay? So what vivasvat prabhatam? What is lit by the sun? Aksham. Okay? Prabhatam aksham. Vivasvat prabhatam aksham. So the eye that is lit by the sun, yatha, in which way the eye that is lit by the sun, kim karoti, pragrinhati. Kim karoti means, what does it do? Pragrinhati. Pragrinhati means catches. Grinhati, to grasp, to catch. So it catches, it objectifies. What does it objectify? What word is left out in that now? Rupam. Clap, clap. Very good. I'm very happy. Rupam. Rupam yatha aksham pragrinhati. Just as the eye catches the form. Rupam here means form. What kind of form? Vivasvat prabhatam. Lit by the sun alone, the eye catches hold of a form. Because in pitch dark, you are groping, you know, you are not doing pragrindham, you know, you are prag-groping, you are not doing pragrindham. Yeah, what is prag-groping? Prakarshena groping, yeah, you are groping around in the dark, you are not catching hold of anything if it's pitch dark. I mean, we are not talking of little night lights here and there, no night light. And so it's very clear that the eye is capable. In other words, if we put this, you know, if we polish up the translation, the eye becomes capable of sight when lit by the sun. The eye falls upon the object and objectifies the object when the sunlight has already fallen upon the object. Yeah, very interesting, you know. All right, we are just seeing the translation now. Then, na abhatam, somebody asks a question here. What if it's not lit up? Kim happens. What is Kim happens? What happens?
You don't see.
You don't see. Evam. Evam means according to what was said before. You know, so that means what? If you have light, if the light falls on the object and the eyes also happen to fall on the object which has been lit up by the sun, then the eyes can say, I have objectified, we have objectified this particular object. This object has come to light. This form has come to light with the help of the eyes. But really speaking, it's not just the eyes, it's the sun that is responsible for the eyes to see. What if the sun is not there? Na abhatam evam means you have to use your buddhi here. How to use the buddhi? So this is what we do. It's a subtle functioning of a logic called anvaya vyatireka, which is used commonly in the teaching. Anvaya means it's kind of a law of an invariable concomitance. So for example, you know, if this condition is there, then that is there. If light is there, the form comes to light. And if light is not there, dot dot dot,
it doesn't
come to light. This is simple anvaya vyatireka. So the form doesn't come to light. Evam means please infer according to what was said before. Okay, now then yada abhatah abhasayati yada abhatah vivasvan, we have to carry here, yada abhatah vivasvan abhasayati akshamekah. And here this is a very it's a slightly difficult way of saying something which is not so difficult. And what is he saying? He's saying yada, let me find the anvaya here. Yeah, so na abhatam, and there is a pun here. Na abhatam we can use in two ways. I will tell you how. Here we first go to the word in the second line, akshamekaha. Akshamekaha means the only eye. Only eye? How many eyes are there? Are we talking of a cyclops? You know, the big head and one eye in the middle? Only eye means what? Consciousness, awareness, the only eye, the all-seeing eye of awareness, of consciousness, which is what nitya upalabdhi svarupaha, that which has been described repeatedly as that which is ever available, always the same and always there. So then what happens to that? This all-seeing eye, and we have to translate as all-seeing self, abhasayati. Abhasayati means what? Brings to light. What? The sun. The sun. Not S-O-N, S-U-N. Yeah. Very interesting. This is the translation. So, the eyes objectify form when that said form is lit by the sun, and they do not are incapable of objectifying the form when not so lit. But then the all-seeing eye, which is nitya upalabdhi svarupa, which is ever-present consciousness, lights up even the sun. This is the translation. This is a very beautiful way of looking at it. And I told you there is a pun here. And what is the pun? It is there in the word na abhatam. Not lit up. And that we took it earlier to say when the and here we can use that to also say even when the sun doesn't shine. Who says the sun is not shining? That consciousness which is ever present as what? As I. Atma is the one that is the whole, that is wonderful. And here we have a slight departure from so far talking about what we call Tvam Pada Vichara. That is important to note. What is Tvam Pada Vichara? Inquiry into the word you. Why should we inquire into the word you? Huh? In the Mahavakya, Tattva, as illustrated by the Mahavakya, Tattvamasi, not any you, no. Inquiry, that's why I said word you, not inquiry into you. All these are very important. Yeah. Carefully we have to understand this. So the inquiry, not into you, of course it is into you, but really here, it is into the word you. Which word you? Tattvamasi you. In that Mahavakya, which says you are that. That you, that word you is inquired into. And the word that, in the word you are, in the sentence you are that also is inquired into. What is the that? Okay. So here we see a very wonderful and a subtle movement from the enquiry into the word you to the enquiry into the word that. So from tat, tvam pada vichara, we go towards tat pada vichara here without saying anything. Yeah, very beautifully done. How is that? Because now this whole play with the word sun, you know, first you have the sun lighting up the form. And the eyes are dependent upon the sun to see the form. And then, not only that, the mind, the eyes are dependent upon the mind as well to see the form. Because if the mind is not there, if you are thinking about something else, and your best friend passes by and you don't even acknowledge them, that means what? The eyes were seeing. Mind did not register. Correct? So like this, the eyes, the role of the eyes becomes smaller and smaller and smaller because they are dependent upon so many factors here. First the sun to light up something and then the mind. And so the eyes are just upakarana, a small means to bring something to light. So the eyes, which I think of as extremely important, I means any person, thinks of it as extremely crucial, is hardly crucial at all. Because first we need the light, then we need the mind to be properly functioning, and then the mind itself becomes an object. When does the mind become an object? When the subject starts to objectify the mind, and when the mind is watched. So when you start to watch the mind, what happens? Mind quickly sits down and behaves. Yeah, that's why to watch the mind. Yeah, it goes like this, shh, and sits down and start to say Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. That's why to watch the mind. Watch mind is a well-behaved and a quiet mind. And so here, the mind itself is watchable, which means the mind is not the subject of sight. So now what is, see, the sun is not the subject of sight because it's only a necessary but not a sufficient condition. Because just because the sunlight is falling on something, that doesn't mean it will come to light unless the presence of the eyes is there. And the presence of the eyes is also again a necessary but not sufficient condition because the light and the eyes have to coexist at the same time. Okay, both of them are there, but still the mind can be elsewhere, so the mind is given a big arati of welcome. Tilak and garland, okay, please come into the picture. And then what? Then the mind also just scurries away. Scurries away. Why? Because it too becomes an object in the presence of what? I am the one who make this mind an object. Correct? I am the one who is witnessing this mind unfolding into its various crazy thoughts and crazy impressions and crazy, what's it called, inferences. So first, you know, the eyes watch the unfolding mithya with the help of the mind, right, in this scenario. And then the mind, you know, cooks up another mithya based upon what the eyes have brought it. Information, eyes are just little gophers. They say, okay, there is something happening over there. And the mind says, that happened last time also. This is not a good sensation. I don't think this is, you know, last time it had a bad end. When I was three, but I've forgotten all that. So this is not good news. So the mind, you know, starts to go into SOS alarm mode, you know. Yeah. Like that, you know, at night sometimes, you know, I was staying in some hotel in Washington, D.C. and the most horrible noise greeted me at 2 in the morning. I said, who died? What happened? You know, it was terrible noise. It was some fire alarm that somebody had set off, we came to know later. And everybody had to evacuate. You had to evacuate and go out and, you know, and people brought their luggage. It was a sight to see, you know. And people brought their pet animals. They were also staying in a hotel along with the people. And so, you know, this is what the whole thing is. So here, the mind goes into this alarm mode because the eyes just saw something innocently. And they just told the mind. And the mind, because it is capable of making inferences, it's capable of linking series of thoughts, it is blessed with memory, it can make some, you know, it can make some connections with the past, and it can predict some things based on that, subjective predictions, but nonetheless. And then the mind goes into a warped circle of its own. This is called, you know, when it comments upon the mithya, and then it goes into that Ferris wheel of all kinds of, you know, sensations of this impression of what it saw. That is called mithya within mithya. Correct? You see, simple sight is not so simple. So if Hastamalaka had stopped at this, at the mind, and said, okay, the mind alone is the one that is there, and then this nitya upalabdhi swarupa atma is lighting up the mind, then it would still have been tvam pada vichara. But what does he do? He brings in Vivaswan. Who is this Vivaswan? Son. So why this extra thing? I mean, he could have just gone eyes, mind, and then, you know, and then Atma. Atma that backs up, Pratyagatma, that Atma that is the witness of the mind, of the eye, of the impressions gathered therein. He could have gone that route, and he already had gone that route. But here, if you look closely, there is a significant, slight but significant shift here. And what is that shift? The shift has to do with looking at what is it, at the nature of what is it that is powering the mind, or powering the eyes ultimately. First we say sun, and the sun is an object of worship in India. Sun is not worshipped. Bhagavan is worshipped as the sun. Tat savituhu varenyam bhargo devasya dhimahi. Oh, where have I heard this? Gayatri mantra. I'm glad nobody said Bhagavad Gita. Chapter 15. Because last time I had given carte blanche, because if I say where, I said you can say Bhagavad Gita if you want. And likely will be correct, except in these kinds of situations. You see, every rule has an exception. So this is the Gayatri, the very famous, brilliant Gayatri mantra that is chanted for brilliance. And so what now? Tat Savituhu Varenyam. That which is, and this is from the Veda, of course, that which is the source of the sun, that sun-like brilliance, Savituhu, of the sun. That brilliance of the sun, which is Bhagavan's brilliance. And now you see only one brilliance, which is at once lighting up the sun and the Buddhi, which is the seer of the sun. Do you see this now? And who is this brilliance? What is this brilliance? Bhargaha, bridge. Bridge, dahane. The root verb bridge means to burn, that which burns. So it's a searing brilliance. Oh, like barbecue? No, not like that. Yeah, it barbecues something. What does it barbecue, this brilliance? It barbecues the karma kebabs. Yes. All the karmic kebabs that are there, it skewers them, roasts them, chars the karma. This is what this brilliance does. Bhargaha, the one who chars and burns down karma, whose worship burns down karma, whose brilliance is enough to burn down all kinds of karma, sanchita karma, agami karma, prarabdha karma, many other karma, korma, everything. It burns everything down. How does it burn karma? Because this is what I have been wanting to hear. I have been getting exhausted trying to exhaust my karma. And here you say this worship of Bhagavan is burning down karma. How? Through the giving, through the gift of Viveka, for self-knowledge. That is how it burns down karma. Karma is burnt down through the fire of self-knowledge, for which we need this brilliance in the form of an altar of worship, an altar of surrender, where I become capable of laying down all my karmas. I dedicate the karma to this altar so that I free myself relatively from guilt and hurt. So bhargaha, tat savituhu. See, even here we have, when we are talking of tat pada, what does Gayatri mantra start with? The word what? Tat. Om bhur bhuvasvaha is called vyahritis. We don't count that. Om we count. Om tat savitur. It's beautiful. What a connection. How beautiful. Tat Savituhu Varenyam. Tat Savituhu Devasya Dhimahi. Tat Varenyam. That alone is to be chosen. That single brilliance, that single searing brilliance that is capable of burning down my karma rashi, the karma pile up. If you look into the karma, it's like a junkyard full of disembodied, rusting metallic parts. Nothing even makes sense. Oh, what is this? This is a muffler, not what you tie around here. Muffler means what? You know that, which is that pipe. Yeah. Noisy karma. This is a muffler? What is this? Which janma did I get it? Who remembers? Who knows? All disembodied. There is a door, there is a window. There is a tire, a tired tire. All the engines are exhausted. Battery that is being powered down, powered out, run out of power, disempowered battery. It's like a junkyard. And all that is lit in flames by the simple invocation of that brilliance which negates the karma by showing its spoof. What is the spoof? That there is no karma. But there is no karta. If there is no karta, how can there be karma? No, maybe before there was karta. You know? What do you do to such a person who says, before there was karta? Before there were so many things. Before there was karta means before there was ajnanam also. As long as there is ajnanam, karta remains. Karta and ajnanam have a very happy marriage. They love each other very much. Karta means doer. Ajnanam means ignorance. Doership and ignorance. Wonderful marriage. They never argue and each one compliments the other. So wonderful association. And when do they have a falling out? When the karta is questioned by this teaching, ajnanam abandons the karta. That's what happens. And the karta says, oh, I'm no longer karta. I'm an as though karta. So this unholy marriage lasts only as long as there is ignorance. The ignorance is spirited away, burnt away by relatively, on the relative level, invoking that brilliance, converting it into an altar of surrender, praying for clarity. What is clarity here? Viveka, that is clarity. What kind of clarity? Not clarity about tattvamasi, clarity to make and keep on the right decisions in my life. That is what Gayatri Mantra is about. May I be always capable of making the right decisions. May I be in the right place at the right time and choose the correct thing. Tadeva Varenyam, that alone is to be chosen. Dhimahi, we invoke. Bhargaha, that brilliance. And what should this brilliance do? What are we asking for this fire to do? Dhiyaha naha prachodayat. Naha means what? Our. Yeah, na means no. Remember the beginning of the class. Naha means ours. Yeah. So, naha means our. Dhiyaha, and same thing, the word dhiya is used here also. Dhiya means what? Intellects. Naha, our intellects, prachodayat, may they stimulate. Yes, stimulate. Prachodanam kuryat. May they stimulate our intellect. May this brilliance, not they, may this brilliance stimulate our intellect. This Bhagavan, in the form of the one who takes away all karma, do that. And that Bhagavan, that brilliance, here is referred to as Vivasvan. And why do we say this is a Tatpada moment or a turn towards the Tatpada here? Because the Upanishads, all of them, are full of references. Just like this Gayatri Mantra that we illustrated just now, are full of references about the human being who is like that which is nothing, who is non-separate from the sun. Non-separate from the sun? No, only in the form of the Adhishthana Devata of brilliance. The sun is invoked not as some, you know, an object of worship, but as the presiding deity of brilliance that lights up my intellect. In fact, just like the sun lights up the world of names and forms, really speaking, that brilliance, you know, may it abide in me, may I understand it, because with the help of this light, light up all names and forms, light up even my own ignorance, so that then it can be taken away through choosing knowledge. So in the Taittiriya Upanishad, Yosa vasau purushah sohamasmi yaschayam purushe yaschasavadityye yaschasau adityye. This purusha here, So aham asmi, that I am. Which are you? Which that are you? The same entity that is found in the sun. If you look in the sun, you find an entity. Inside all the solar flares is hiding an entity. No, that which makes the sun shine, that entity, that conscious being, that entity, that Bhagavan, who is in charge of the whole universe. So here we have been looking at Bhagavan only all this time. But from the standpoint of Adhyatma, what is Adhyatma? With reference to oneself, Atmanam Adhikritya Tishthati. So we are seeing it from the individual standpoint, that same Bhagavan, and we have a name for that. What do we call it? Nitya Upalabdhi Swarupaha Atma Aham. Correct? Now we are looking at this from the standpoint of Adhibhuta and Adhideva. From the standpoint of the, with reference to the surroundings, from a collective standpoint. And there are two manifestations of this same brilliance, which obtains as I, as the truth of I. There are two other standpoints that are needed to complete this vision of Tattvamasi, of this wholeness. And what are the two standpoints? Both are collective standpoints. In the first collective standpoints, we invoke Bhagavan as one of the elements, right? Not as the element itself, as that which powers the element, the truth of that element. So in sun we invoke fire, because the fire gives us daylight, fire gives us temperature, fire gives sight. So as the presiding deity of the fire, you see, that presiding deity of the element, we invoke that, and that is called, you know, the Adhibhuta, the presiding deity of fire, presiding deity of water. What do you mean by presiding deity? You just told me if you clear out all the solar flares, there is no deity, there is no entity. That which makes the sun, that which makes the water flow, that which makes the fire burn, okay? And with regard to the water, it may have a different name. With regard to the fire, it has a different name. That same power which has branched off in various ways with reference to a particular element or a particular function, a particular name and form, which is really the place where all names reside. So this is called Adhibhuta. And then finally we have what? Adhideva or Adhidaivikam. And what is this Adhideva? The law which connects the Adhibhuta and Adhyatma. Like if we see prana, you know what is this? Vayu. You can't see it, but you have to infer. You can touch it. Vayu. And then take a deep breath. What do you call what is sitting in the lungs that you are waiting to exhale? Prana. How did that vayu become prana? Prana with reference to Adhyatma, that same vayu gets the name prana with reference to the individual lung. Yeah. Lung means L-U-N-G. Okay, not past tense. Yeah, that's also lung. But here, lung here is the place where the air is metabolized to form new cells, to have the function of cell renewal. Where? In somebody else's body. No, in my own body. That's why it's Adhyatma. So when I breathe, your cells don't get rejuvenated, correct? How do you know? Because I have not yet been able to stop breathing. Because if somebody else can breathe for me, why should I breathe? But since I am not able to stop breathing, as of now, I conclude that, okay, this is Maha inference. What do I conclude? I conclude that this respiration, my respiration, and what is respiration other than the aspiration of the air, which is outside and then taking it in and then calling, as soon as it enters this body, I say my prana, you see. And so this pranic activity of taking in the air and throwing out the waste, whatever is not needed, all the tired cells and all the, you know, carbon dioxide, which is toxic, is put out into the atmosphere. So this is adhyatma, the same air, what function it does in the body is called adhyatma. And that the air is available for breathing. Sancharati, it keeps moving here and there. You know, it's never stagnant. It's always moving, even though sometimes because of humidity it feels stagnant. It's not really stagnant. There is a breeze. It moves. That's why it's called anilaha. It doesn't, you know, it has certain characteristics of its own. And then it has the right combination of oxygen and nitrogen and everything else that makes up whatever that is, that atmosphere. So the atmospheric air is not a random occurrence, correct? Everywhere it's the same. Wherever there is atmosphere, it has a certain composition that is stable. So this is called adhibhuta, because there is a, as it were, a presiding intellect, if not entity. There is a presiding intellect, Bhagavan or Ishvara, in the form of that which makes sure that the atmosphere, wherever it occurs, is consistent and it is available for respiration. Not just for you, but for everything that breathes, from plants onwards. Not just for human beings. This is Adhibhuta, same Bhagavan looked upon as Adhibhuta. And then finally, there is Adhideva, means what? Adhidaivikam means that law that is at the heart of these other two. What other two? The individual and the collective. That which connects the individual to the collective, that which can be seen as that ultimate source of both adhyatma and adhibhuta, and that which is in the form of a law. Wherever there is respiration, this is how it will behave. Wherever there is air, this is how it will behave. And supposing I'm not able to breathe, air goes in but doesn't come out, you know, everybody is waiting, you know, what happened? Body gone, well, I'm not able to exhale, that is also within that order. Bhishasmad vatah pavate, bhishodeti suryah, bhishasmad agnishchendrascha, mrityurdhavati panchama iti. As if out of respect or fear of which the air, the wind blows, the sun shines, and Indra and Agni do their jobs, and death, that makes everyone runs according to whose laws? This is Adhideva. Okay? Did you understand this whole kind of a thing? So up till now, these first 6-7 verses were talking about with reference to Pratyagatma, or the inwardly obtaining sentience. What is its characteristics? How it is not connected to the body-mind-sense complex, this inwardly obtaining sentience. And now we make a departure and you kind of take off. Yes. Take off to what? Seeing broader connections, seeing the broad picture, because this is a good picture, it's a wonderful picture. It is the picture of the truth of this I, but it is not a complete picture. You know? Because you need a few other shades and tones and pieces to complete the picture. you know, we wanted to have something printed at this FedEx. And I said, you know, they said, would you like a proof? I said, sure. Please give one proof. Photo of Pujya Swamiji. Please give a proof. The proof was brought. And what was the proof? This much part of the face, literally. All the way from the head, this much. So you saw little pieces of the eye, and I think the whole nose was there, and half the lips, and a little bit of the chin, little bit of the neck, and like this. A small sliver. And, you know, most disappointing, the proof. This much. Do you have that here? So, this much, tiny bit, you know, and looking at that, I said, why do they call it proof? Yeah, I have to show this. See? And people think I sit here and make things up. I sometimes do, but not on this occasion. So this is, you can say, Tvam Pada Vichara. If you end here, then that means it is Tvam Pada Vichara. That's all. Because you have a little bit of a picture, it's exciting. Because you see Swamiji, a little enough of Swamiji to create the interest. I want more. I want to see the whole thing. Where is the entirety of this picture? What is this that is missing? Something is missing, but what is missing? Here we know the sides of the face are missing because we know what Pujya Swamiji's face looks like. But here we are talking of Atma. Even though we know kind of what it looks like, we don't know what its full nature is. And so up till now we had this much darshan of Atma. And so here this is, you know, filling in on this side, filling in on that side, filling the background and making it, you know, making what is already complete, completing that which is already complete. Yeah. So that the result is not disappointing. You know, like this proof. So then what? Then we have a, you know, so that's why we have to not stop at Adhyatma, because that is just a point of view. Adhyatma and Adhibhuta are a point of view from the standpoint of Jiva and Jagat separation. Just like you cannot stop at Jiva and Jagat. What's missing?
Ishvara.
Ishvara is missing, without whom neither Jiva nor Jagat can, you know, exist. So, when, you know, you say, oh, just Ishvara is missing. What do you mean just Ishvara is missing? You know, you cannot take out the thing which makes the thing, you know, and then what will it become? Nothing. That's what it will become. So here, that is where this whole Vivasvan here, we have to take it at all three levels. The light of the eyes, the sun is Vivasvan to the form in relation to the form, that is upon which it lights, that which it objectifies. So the light of the sun reaches the eyes, blesses the eyes as it were. So here which sun? Adhibhuta sun, just the regular sun, but that sun is not doing its job by itself. It is part of a large order greater than itself, Adhideva. And that Ishvara which is powering the sun is the same Ishvara that is called Nitya Upalabdhi Swarupa Atma. That same Ishvara is the Atma that powers the intellect, that powers the mind, that powers the eyes to see. Very beautiful. So, here Vivasvan is taken to be both Adhyatma, The light of the eyes, when you say, that means what? The sun performs the function, the eyes perform the function of the sun, right? What does the sun do? Lights up objects. What do the eyes do? Lights up, the eye also lights up various objects. Then what? Next? Then we have to look at the sunlight itself, which makes sight possible. That is Adhideva, Adhibhuta. And then you go beyond that and look at the functioning of the eyes with its own presiding deities. That's why the presiding deity of the eye is the sun. If any eye problems are there, you chant Aditya Hridayam. There are 32 verses for sun. They have nothing to do with the eyes. In fact, these 32 verses were given by the sage Vasishtha to Lord Rama. Lord Rama, before he went to war with the king of Sri Lanka, who was that?
Ravana.
Before he went to war with Ravana, had a moment of fright under self-confidence. Lord Rama and no self-confidence? How is that possible? That is what is called human avatar. And so the sage Vasishtha asked him to chant these 32 verses for courage. He had a moment of no courage. Like, will Sita ever come back? Will we be able to succeed in vanquishing this horrible king? Will we be able to be successful? What will happen? All these things, questions came into his mind, and he was asked to chant these verses. But look at the flexibility of the verses, because the verses are for Aditya, the sun. And because of whom the eyes function. And here they are dedicated to the sun, those verses, they also help eyesight. It's not that you are worshipping the sun. What are you worshipping? Adhideva, the presiding deity, you are worshipping, you can say, immediately. But really speaking, you are worshipping Bhagavan, that acts as the lighter upper of the sun and the eyes. Fantastic. That's why we say we have a very sophisticated understanding of Ishvara. Nothing, no other theology can beat this. That is the all-pervasiveness. Oh, everywhere it is present. Nowhere, there is no place where it is not. This is what is, beauty of it. So here this Vivasvan. Who is this Vivasvan? This Vivasvan himself. Here Adhibhuta Vivasvan, the one who is the lighter upper of the universe, what? Dims. When I look upon that eye, that brilliance, which powers this Atma, which powers the sun, and that Ishvara alone, here the same chant is there, Sanitya Upalabdhi Swarupoham Atma. But that Atma is now not with regard to the body-mind-sense complex. That definition of the Atma with regard to the body-mind-sense complex has barreled out of the body-mind-sense complex, has snowballed into incorporating the elements, into incorporating Ishvara. So this Jiva, which thought of it as a lowly fellow, is now the author of the Jagat. And non-separate from Ishvara. So really, hidden in this is a Mahavakya. Just because the word Vivasvan is used, because the sunlight is not a new thing. It was used more as a comparative, illustrative element. But here, it is used as a wonderful segue. Very nice.
यथा सूर्य एकोप्स्वने कश्चलासु
यथा सूर्य एकोप्स्वने कश्चलासु
यथा सूर्यः
यथा सूर्या
एकोप्स्वनेकश्चलासु स्थिरास्वप्यनन्वग्विभाव्यस्वरूपः
I tried to break it but couldn't anyway so
चलासु प्रभिन्नासु
चलासु प्रभिन्नासु
धीष्वेवमेकः
धीष्वेवमेकः सनित्योपलब्धिस्वरूपोऽहमात्मा
यथा जस्ट एज एकः सूर्यः द वन सन अप्सु अप्सु मीन्स इन द वाटर्स The word up is always in plural. You cannot have one water, okay? In the waters, apsu. What kind of water? Sthirasu. And then? Yes, sthirasu, still waters. And then chalasu. Chalasu means moving water. So now there are two kinds of waters. One is a placid lake, quiet lake, where there is not even a ripple. And the other one is a raging gorge, a river. So one is called Sthirasu, quiet, placid, settled body of water, a pond, a lake. And the other one is a raging rapid. Chalasu, always moving. Okay? Now, this, how many suns are there? It has already been told.
One.
One sun. So the one sun, in still and moving bodies of water, what happens? Ananvag vibhavya swarupaha. अनन्वग् विभाव्य स्वरूपः यस्य अनन्वग् विभाति अनन्वग् विभाव्यः विभाव्यः शाइनिंग अनन्वक् अकॉर्डिंग टू और इन अ चेंजिंग मैनर अनन्वक् मीन्स इन अ नॉन चेंजिंग मैनर स्वरूपः हूज नेचर सो हियर दिस लॉन्ग कंपाउंड इज डिस्क्राइबिंग द सन नॉट द वाटर Not the bodies of water. So that one sun, who is of unchanging nature, the one sun doesn't become two. When it is reflected in the flowing river, even though the water, the refractions of the water may seem to split the sun into 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 suns. How many suns are really there?
One
sun. Or in a rapid river, sometimes the sun seems splintered, not one. Aneka, it appears. Many suns are there or pieces of sunlight are there, twinkling because of the waves of the ocean or the waves in the river. How many sun is really there? One sun who has the nature of Ananvag Vibhavyaha. Who is Ananvag Vibhavyaha? Vibhasana Yogyah, the one who is incapable of changing his nature, the sun. He cannot become two, he cannot become splintered, just because different bodies of water manifest him and reflect him differently, it does not affect the sun. The sun does not look at himself in a raging river and says, oh, I'm splintered, I'm fragmented, and starts to weep. Oh, the sun is crying. Yes, sun is crying. Why? Because the sun looked at his reflection in the murky waters and said, oh no, I have become dirty. And he had a brief moment of laughing. And what was the laughter? Because he looked at himself from on high in a placid pond and said, "Ha, I'm good looking. Look how perfectly round I am, and I'm in this lake, look at that." And then he had a solar flare, got very angry. When he looked at himself crashing on a wave which was crashing against a rock. And then he said, "Oh no, that's the end of me. How dare this happen? I'm splintered, I'm fragmented, upset."
Mm-hmm.
Poor son, correct? The sun illustrates something. The sun is drishtanta, and that which it illustrates is given in the next line. What is that? Chalasu prabhinnasu. Chalasu we already know, in the moving, and prabhinna, bhinna means different. In the moving minds, dhishu, in the many minds that are moving, and prabhinnasu means varied, in many and varied minds. What is that? Ekah, that one upalabdhi svarupah atma stays unaffected. In the motor mind. What is a motor mind? The mind that is horse-powered by memories and desires, raga dveshas. That is the gas. Motor mind runs, keeps running, makes inferences, wrong ones always. You know, oh, this happened, so that happened, and oh, somebody said something about me, so I have to protect myself. And I have to defend myself, and somebody is attacking me, so I have to hide, and somebody is, you know, after me. It's always us against them, me and them, I and they, so the they becomes bigger than the I becomes smaller, 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 and then sits and cries, you know, because everything is overpowering. Dvaitadhi bhayam bhavati. Because of duality, there is fear and sorrow. Duality is the cause of sorrow and fear. And so this heightened insecurity, all because of what? The duality outside or the duality here? That is the question. The duality here, naturally. Because what is the duality here? The mind is running, you know, is weaving a parallel universe, mithya within mithya. It is weaving a parallel universe. You know, that's why when you read these stories, some of these fairy tales are not very nice. You know, this what is that? Sleeping Beauty. This one, yeah, Sleeping Beauty. And there's and some others also I have read, where there's always this wicked woman who is weaving something. She's always weaving something, correct? She has that loom and she's weaving something. I think this is upalakshana for the mind that has turned away from Bhagavan. What do we mean turned away from Bhagavan? Sitting, stewing in its own alienation. That's all it is. Turned away from Bhagavan means when you start weaving a parallel universe, Bhagavan says, "Okay, my job is done. You continue." So so your own universe becomes bigger than the reality in which it sits. So your personal, you're powered by your own personal universe with a warp and weft of prejudices and desires, or you live in Ishvara's universe happily. Even now, forget ever after, right now, Jivan Muktaha. The latter is Jivan Mukti, the former is bondage. A notion, first which starts out as a notion, soon becomes an ocean. Because it overwhelms, overpowers. So here, the chalasu prabhinnasu dhishu. So the motor mind that runs and creates a new parallel reality. The sad mind, depressed mind, oh, I don't think I'll get out of bed today. Why? Look how it is. What's the point? Apathetic mind, rajasic mind, tamasic mind, and then what else? The mind that is trying to attain things, you know, the collector mind. You know, sometimes there are people like this, they just keep collecting information. What for? I don't know. They're information collectors. They make a time to see you. Okay, please come. You know, when somebody makes a time to see me, I think, okay, they want to ask something, or they have some questions, or whatever it is. Immediately they start asking the questions. So, what are you doing now? Right now I'm talking to you. When did you come? Yesterday. When are you leaving? Tomorrow. So, where are you going? Why are you going? What is that going to help? How is that going to help? Knowing so many things about one person, how is that going to help? What did you eat? What are you going to eat tomorrow? How is that going to help? But that is again coming from a place of insecurity. One's own insecurity is an overcompensation, a compensatory mechanism, psychological. Psychologists call it a compensatory mechanism, because one is insecure, one feels insecure, everything is out of control. So the information, the more I gather information, the more I am in a place of control, and that feels good. That is how it is. So that kind of a mind which is always trying to look into something or the other, the distracted mind, you know, ADD mind, the mind which you have to keep on saying never mind, because what's the use, can't count on it. The sad mind, the mad mind, is the same, what, brilliance, that same Vivasvan, that same sun-like brilliance here, that Bhagavan is powering all the minds. So where is Bhagavan sitting? He's got a remote control or what? Click, 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 click. Oh, that jiva there, I don't like him. Click. Where is this powering happening? Right here, right now. It's not some Bhagavan. It's not like the mind is a puppet of Bhagavan and Bhagavan is pulling strings. Because that's a very stringy explanation. It's not fun. There is no Bhagavan outside of you. That Upalabdhi Swarupa Atma, which is Nitya, which is all the time the same, which is unchanging. That same I appears, manifests differently in different minds, in different bodies, in different intellects. The sad mind, from the sad mind to the mad mind, it's the same Ishvara that is occupying that. Then why does the Ishvara get distorted? The answer to that is what? Why does Ishvara get distorted? Means why does the sun get distorted in the reflection? No, but the sun is not distorted. Exactly. Yeah. So, chalasu prabhinnasu dhishu evam ekaha. Evam in the same manner. Ekaha. Ekaha atma. Nitya upalabdhi svarupaha yasya aham asmi. I am that unchanging one in moving, still, diverse, raging, staging, engaging intellects. Just like, and what is the illustration? The one sun, you know, anekaha api, even though appearing as splintered and many in different bodies of water. Because the sun as though takes on the nature of the bodies of the water in the varied and many reflections, so too in the dhis, in the various reflecting mediums, so to speak, in the buddhis, the sun, this brilliance which is Ishvara, this brilliance, sun-like brilliance which is Bhagavan, takes on many different forms, is never afflicted, is never distorted. So I have a plan, so that concludes the lecture for today. I have a plan, and the plan is that we will finish this text a little earlier, and Medha Suktam needs a little more time. So I may finish this, what is tomorrow? Friday. I won't finish this tomorrow, probably Monday or Tuesday I will finish this text. And then we will have two or three, depending on when I finish this, extra classes of Medha Suktam. That is what we will do, because it's at the same time. Okay? Yeah, so that is the plan.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
Questions? Same, Vivasvan. It's called Vivasvan. That's why I said. Ah, that's why I said. That's why we cannot look at it as the sun. We have to go to Bhagavan. Ah, yes, yes. That's easy to miss because, you know, it's a very, it's not an easy text.
No.
Yeah. I read a few lines of Gita. As I am the one who is doing everything, the question is why this buddhi is given to us if God is doing everything? God is buddhi. Yeah, buddhi is God given. Buddhi is God. That's all it is. That's why you have to dedicate the buddhi to God. That's all it is. Yeah. Any other questions here? Yes.
Back to sattvic behaviors.
Sattvic behaviors, yeah. Okay.
So, in trying to get this through, in piecing together different behaviors in life,
yeah,
things that I do. And so I want to know if this is a constructive thing for me to do or not, because generally, I don't know. So in a rajastic behavior, let's see, so it's Tamas first. So tamasic behavior, I see myself walking a crocodile. I'm going to take the crocodile for a walk. In a rajastic behavior, I want to do something. I'm in the process of doing something, I realize I'm holding a shark. And in a sattvic behavior, I'm sitting in the chariot with Rama next to me. I mean, when I was doing seva, I was looking at the differences between what's true and what's not true. So, if this is going off here, there's the crocodiles in the room, and then I can sit and some, then things happen if I'm sitting next to.
Yes.
It seems constructive for me now.
Yeah, if it works, that's wonderful. If it works, it's a good, it's good to be able to distinguish and notice when one is getting off the sattva seat. Because if you leave the sattva seat, then you automatically are either rajasic or tamasic or perhaps a combination of the two. So therefore, it's not always easy to be sattvic all the time. So therefore, we take help of lifestyle options. We take the lifestyle options of sattva as a crutch, so that I at least through the choices of eating, drinking, and you know, all these activities, I do the correct things, the correct attitude, all these things. So the best way is what you are doing right now is you are noticing when you are not in sattva. That's a wonderful way to come, bring back the mind, bring back the activities, and come back to a place from which you can start again with more clarity, with more calmness, with more awareness. So if that is useful, that is wonderful. Yeah. Anything else? Picture was very helpful to explain the concept. Yeah, that's why, you know, we usually have pot and clay, but today was, we had this at hand.
The son of
Bhagi Shastri, who was my Sanskrit teacher years ago in Benares, he called me once. He said, "You are a Makar. Makar is a crocodile, no?"
Makara is Makara. A crocodile.
So why would he say that to me? He laughed. He was a child.
Makara also means like a Capricorn. It's Capricorn. Makara. That
astrology?
Also means. Yeah. So Makara is the sign of Capricorn. They say, so I don't know what he meant.
Me neither. Years I've been thinking about it. What did he mean?
Panini in an hour. Yes.
Yes, I have the
Panini in an hour. What is that?
No?
I have the Panini.
Ah, good. Hand it out, please, and give me one also.
I hope they're close.